إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعين به ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح لهذه الأمة فتركها على المحجة البيضاء ليلها كنهارها لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, when the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam died, the Muslim nation went through a huge turbulence. It was a critical moment in the lives of Muslims. Things started changing and the calmness started changing. And people showed up in different places claiming that they are prophets. Other people stopped paying zakat. Many tribes of the Arabs rejected Islam and went back to their original religion. It reached to an extent that Jum'ah has almost stopped, except in Mecca and in Medina. The best description by Urwa radiallahu anhu, the companion of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, we were like the lost sheep in the dark, rainy, cold night because we lost the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We were few in numbers and we had enemies encircling us from all direction. That mood of depression and dismay did not reach Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. He stood up against it and refused to declare himself as a loser. And he confronted all of such challenges that were around them as a Muslim nation. And immediately he prepared an army to fight those who claimed they are prophets, and also those who have rejected the religion and gave back Muslims their dignity and pride. 400 years forward, at the year 417, the Karmatians, in Arabic we call them Karamita, the Karmatians had attacked Mecca on the day of Hajj, Yom Tarwiyah. They slaughtered every single person performing Hajj in the Haram itself. And they kept on with their swords, killing people in Mecca, in Hajj. The approximate figures of people killed on the Hajj day at that year were 30,000. Their emir, his name Abu Tahir al-Janabi, may Allah's curse be on him, he sat at the Kaaba door, at the entrance of the Kaaba. And he could see his men slaughtering Muslims coming to Hajj. And the swords are killing them. And it's on the day of Tarwiyah, the first day of Hajj, which is the most sacred day throughout the Muslim year. And he said, I am Allah, and Allah is in me. I create and I can make people die. Then he commanded his men to remove al-Hajar al-Aswad, the black rock in Kaaba, to have it dismantled and removed. And then he said, where are Tayr al-Ababil? The same, you know, Surah al-Fil. He's challenging Allah Almighty. He says, where are the birds that are supposed to come from the sky and throw these fiery rocks at me? Nothing has happened. So the black rock, Hajar al-Aswad, was removed, and he and his group took it away to their country. It stayed with them 22 years. 22 years, Muslim attended Hajj and Umrah with no Hajar al-Aswad. All what they did is they used to put their hands in the cavity where the Hajar al-Aswad was and finish the Hajj or Umrah. 22 years later, they have returned al-Hajar al-Aswad to this place due to the problems that he had in his part. Move forward. 100 years later, at the year of 580 of Hijrah, almost less than 200 years forward to the Muslims, the Crusades have attacked the Muslim territories and the Muslim countries in 9 consecutive attacks. And they have killed and massacred Muslims everywhere. And the level of violence was beyond the norm. And they took over many of the Muslim territories. They closed even al-Masjid al-Aqsa in Palestine, till there was no Jum'ah or Jama'ah done in Masjid al-Aqsa. Not only that, they have placed their cross on top of al-Masjid al-Aqsa for almost 100 years. A lot of Muslims became in despair, and they felt that there is a loss in that thing. And there is no hope that Muslims can win over the war against the Crusades. It was estimated that the killing that took place in one day, well over 70,000 Muslims were killed. Yet, no one realized that the day will come where Salah al-Din al-Ayyubi, in the war of Hattin, he fought their armies and pushed them out of the Muslim territories. Then again, I move forward to the year of 700 of Hijrah. This is where the Mongols, they have attacked Muslim territories, that is in Iraq especially. What they have done is beyond what mankind can think. The killing and the slaughtering of people and taking the money and whatever values the people took, they killed everything around them. And they created masses of the skulls of men, women, and Muslim children that were killed. They made it into a large heap, like a mountain, to their leader, Hulaku, for this to show how much they are fierce in killing Muslims. They used to kill everybody who was in front of them, these Mongols. They have killed scholars, old men, women, children. They burned mosques. Even the libraries that the Muslims had, all of their books were also destroyed. And if I remember, as they describe, even the two rivers in Iraq, they became black from the amount of books that were thrown into these rivers and the ink, dissolved in the water. All of such, literature, culture the Muslims had, and science was all destroyed. They have burnt up mosques, and they have burned up libraries, and they destroyed everything that is related to the Islamic civilization. Imam Ibn Kathir, he estimates the numbers of Muslims killed during the Mughal invasion, approximately 1,800,000 to 2 million Muslims at that time. It was so drastic that Ibn al-Athir, one of the Muslim scholars of history, he said, I remained several years hesitant to write about that dark side in the Muslim history. I was, every time I want to write about it, I don't feel good about it. And it's difficult for me to write the condolences of so many Muslims being killed. I wish I was not there at that time, and I wish I was not that person who writes about that. Then on came Saifuddin Qutuz in the war of Ain Jalut, and he fought those Mongols and pushed them back to where they became, and Muslims got their dignity. أقول ما تسمعون وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان يوم الدين. Muslims nowadays are facing a different challenge. Although you have seen from the small examples I've given you throughout the histories of Muslims, there were times of challenges and turbulences, and Muslims came out strong after that. Let me remind you one thing. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "The voice of Abi Talha in the army is better than 1,000 men." The voice of Abi Talha, the companion of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is more powerful than 1,000 men. This is only his voice of Abi Talha. And the 1,000 men are not men of our day and age. The men at the days and the days of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. His voice only, let alone his power when he takes out his sword. Think about this point. Why is Abi Talha's voice so important to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? It's because what he had in his heart, the sincerity towards Allah Almighty, that had given him the power. Al-Imam Ibn al-Jawzi said in a marvelous statement, he said, "The brave is the person who wears his heart above his shield, and the coward is a person who wears the shield on top of his heart." The brave wears his heart above his battle shield. The coward wears his shield above his heart. I'll take you to another example. When Muslims invaded Kabul, the leader, Qutaybah ibn Muslim, he had 100,000 fighters. Among them was Muhammad ibn Wasi', a well-known scholar. Before the war that took place, he said to his generals, "Find out where Muhammad ibn Wasi'. I want to know whether he is around here or not." They searched for him and they saw him praying the two rak'ahs of duha. And after he finished the two rak'ahs, he leaned on his spear and then he raised his hands in prayer to Allah Almighty. And he pointed his finger towards the heavens. He said, "Ya Hayyu Ya Qayyum bi rahmatika nastaghith, Allahumma ansurna." O Allah Almighty, we seek your support. O Allah, give us victory. His generals went back to their leader, Qutaybah ibn Muslim, and they told him what they saw. Then he said that statement. He said, "By Allah Almighty, that there is no God but Allah Almighty." His index finger pointing to the heavens is more important to me than 100,000 fighters and 100,000 swords. End of the statement. Do you understand from these two situations something that is unique? I'll add something. You remember one day the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ told his companions, "The day will come when nations of all types will start attacking you as Muslims." So the companion said to the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, "Is it because we are a minority?" He said, "No, you're not a minority, but you are huge numbers and masses." So what was the problem? He said, you become like the foam that floats on top of water, that is on the sides of the river banks. In the meaning of foam is a large quantity, but it has no value. So he said to the companions that your numbers are great numbers, but your value is so little. From these examples, you notice one aspect between victory and defeat to the Muslims. It's not the number of masses. It's not how much weapons you have in hand. It is your relationship with Allah Almighty. In all these cases, you have noticed a single person could be worth 100,000 fighters. His voice is well over 100,000 fighters. This is something for Muslims that this day and age, where we are being pushed and shoved internally and externally, and being framed into issues that Islam has nothing to do with it, it's time for us to review our relationship with Allah. It's a signature, it's a sign, it's a warning sign for Muslims everywhere that the overall average in sincerity and faith towards Allah Almighty has reached critical levels. If you and I do not review the type of special relationship between us and Allah Almighty, we will become targets as what is happening nowadays in the world. I ask Allah Almighty to give us the blessings and the peace and the power and the good special relationship with Allah Almighty. Allahumma ighfir lil mu'minina wal mu'minat, al muslimina wal muslimat, al ahya'i minhum wal amwat, innaka sami'un mujib ad-da'wat. Allahumma ighfir lana dhunubana wa israfana fi dinina wa aslih fasada qulubana wa ruddana ilayka raddan jamila. Allahumma man arada bil islam wal muslimina khair fawaffiqhu lima fihi al khair, wa man arada al islam wal muslimina sharra faj'al sharra fi nahri wa tadbirihi fi tadbirihi. Allahumma ishfi mardana wa mardal muslimin, Allahumma arham mawtana wa mawtal muslimin, Allahumma ij'alna min ahli القرآن يا رب العالمين. اللهم ارزقنا لذة النظر إليك والشوق إلى لقائك من غير ضراء مضرة فتن مضلة. اللهم نسألك من خير ما سألك عبدك ونبيك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، ونعوذ بك من شر ما استعاذ منه عبدك ونبيك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. عباد الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. وأقم الصلاة.